Sandy, that's my better side.
We didn't know you had one.
Thanks, Gary. I appreciate that. Now I can just be more self-conscious than I am. It's not that hard to understand. The preacher who said, and this is the truth, he said, in respect to these texts this morning, I mean food offered to idols, yeah, there's a burning issue for us. He said, I would much prefer to talk about the Super Bowl, but that's not why we're here this morning. But that being said, I have to tell you, my head says New England, my gut says Philly. I don't know what it is, but my gut says the Eagles, and I don't know if it's a manifestation of a previously hidden prophetic gift, or that feeling in my gut would be the two White Castles I had yesterday. So what I would just simply say to you is, don't call that guy in Vegas yet, and don't use my name. It is, of course, the year 2018, and all of us in this room, we've been to lots of parties and celebrations, and we've been to receptions, and yet I would be willing to bet, not on the Eagles, but on this, that not even so much as once in your life, not once, have you come to a party and seen a ubiquitous tray of mozzarella or Swedish meatballs set before an idol of Aphrodite. So one wonders what precisely that second reading might have for us. I mean, I can imagine somebody privately thinking to themselves, you know, in the interest of time, maybe we could have just skipped it. And yet, not all that long ago, true story, a Toronto pastor who wrestled with this text publicly from the pulpit, who had a lot of the same reservations that I just gave voice to, and I acknowledge some of you may have, and that's okay. He said, this woman, at the end of the service, came up to him, and a young Christian lady, and she said, my boyfriend is Hindu. And she said, I was wondering about that because I went to a big family celebration and there were all of these Indian dishes set before pictures and images and statues of Hindu deities. And your words this morning were so helpful to me. Seriously, let's be honest. Who would have dared to think it? But deep below the issue of culinary delight set before idols in Metro Corinth is an issue that goes a lot deeper than that. It is an enduring issue. It is the crux of the matter. It is one of the perennial questions. Am I my sister's keeper? Am I my brother's keeper? And what Paul basically says to those people, and he says to you and me this morning, is you better believe you are. You, and Paul has been talking about this. Last week he was talking about it. He talks a lot about it in Galatians. But he says you have freedom in Christ. As a Christian, you have rights. You have rights. But he also goes on to say, sometimes it is more important to be loving than to be right. There are people who live their whole lives and they never learn that lesson. It's more important to be loving than to be right. Sometimes in our relationships with each other, it is more important to sacrifice those rights and to set aside that liberty in love for the sake of the other. Better to do that, Paul says, than to say, well, I know better than you, and too bad. Maybe the second lesson this morning, maybe it wasn't such a waste of time after all. It's good to be reminded. But these seven verses this morning from Mark's breathlessly paced gospel are something that I doubt many of us, any of us, can really relate to. Unclean spirits. Unclean spirits. Demonic possession. It is, of course, the 21st century. As I speak right now, there's a two-ton engineering marvel running along the surface of Mars, some 50 million miles that way. And here we are this morning together in an old building, gathered about old traditions, talking about, I guess, a kind of a ghost with a bad attitude. Have you come to destroy us? I know who you are, the God's Holy One. Now, I don't find this hard to believe that whenever that term is mentioned, demonic possession, unclean spirits, some of us, We have images of that old movie, The Exorcist, in our head, flying beds and spinning heads, and green pea soup. At least you're awake this morning. 8:30 people slept through that one. I'll give you credit. But my point would be is, it's kind of hard to relate to. Now, maybe somebody here has had that experience. I'd love to hear your story. But for me, and I've seen a lot. I've seen a lot of strange, inexplicable things, but it's alien to my experience. The closest I can come to such a thing is watching some reality-based, we use that term, reality-based, loosely, ghost hunter show, people running around in the dark, and I know you've seen these. Mm-hmm. People running around in the dark, and ultimately, what are they doing? Scaring themselves and each other half to death is what they're doing. Who? What was that? But even so, when we laugh, as a shepherd of a flock, and particularly this flock, I do not doubt for one second, not a scintilla of doubt do I have, about the reality of a world that is unseen. I have never failed to warn those in my charge that there are certain doors you do not want to open. There are some things you just never fool around with, period. It's that serious. But as a colleague of mine says, it's good that you acknowledge that, but he says, not so fast. Dramatic encounters with the darkness may be blessedly rare. Possession may seem to us this morning kind of outdated and irrelevant. But it is not as foreign an event as we might think. He confesses, I have at times, he said, been possessed by an anger at someone that took me off the rails. A momentary, but all too real, crazy, that led me to say things and to do things that did irreparable harm, and which, to this day, the mere thought of it causes me to be embarrassed. I don't know if there's anyone who can relate to that this morning. Or a foul spirit, a foul and dark spirit of jealousy that can lead to suffocating control, and at the same time is an exquisite form of self-torture, yes? Self-torture. A dark and foul spirit of envy that never stops weighing and measuring and counting and comparing and is incapable of finding delight in the success and the good fortunes of others. A dark and dour spirit of insecurity, of greed. And we have yet to even mention the struggle that many wonderful people have with alcohol, or with drugs, or with gambling. Those three things, in 33 years, those three things I have seen again and again destroy, literally, the promise of a wonderful, wonderful life. But recently, don't look now, but the mental health community is finally starting to slowly come around to the reality in the face of a mountain of undeniable evidence, of a serious, almost epidemic, of what is known as pornography addiction. A pornography addiction which, I'm sure you're not surprised, affects men more so than women, but it grabs women as well, and effectively leads people away from the joys and the hardships and the complexities of real, genuine flesh and blood relationships for a sad and fake substitute. The list, I guess we could go this morning, is not endless, but we could spend more time, all of us, putting together a list that's a lot longer than what I have mentioned. Maybe ultimately, and this is somebody said to me in a text study, maybe one of the things that brings us here this morning, you and I, is the acknowledgement of our own unique crazy. We all have it. We all have it. Paul says last week, I will not allow myself to be dominated by anything, and yet the truth is about me and all of us. We all have our own unique battles with the darkness, and things that threaten to dominate you have no impact on me at all. And things that allure me, you would look and say, you must be joking. An acknowledgement of our own crazy. Whatever that thing or that force is that threatens to dominate us, He brings us ultimately to Jesus because we see in him one who, without any official standing, without any credentials from the temple committee, who is the true prophet, because he says it and it becomes a reality, an undeniable authority, because we sense in this person the real deal, a power that is not coercion or threats or violence, but a power of genuine, real love. A love that is not impatient with you in your crazy, or dismissive of you in your crazy, or condescending of you, who in spite of whatever it is that threatens to derail you and dominate you, loves you just the same. And so we come again and again to that love, that divine love. And oftentimes it's not like, as some of those slick TV evangelists say, a magical one-shot deal. I was a terrible guy and used to kick the dog, but I came to Jesus and now everything is perfect. I'm sure you've never heard that before. Maybe not as colorfully stated, but it's the truth. But oftentimes it's not a one-shot magical deal. But coming into his presence, our broken lives feel the cool breeze of liberty. We get a taste of freedom in his presence, freedom that betokens the certainty of a new day. These texts this morning, food offered to idols, demonic possession, they're not as out of touch and as irrelevant as we might have previously thought. We could have talked about the Super Bowl, but I'm glad we didn't. Amen.